Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message, and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John concludes a series entitled, Can I Trust God? Abraham wanted a godly bride for Isaac, and so he sent a trusted servant back to the family he left behind to find a wife for his son. This was a difficult task, and Eliezer received help from the Lord. He stopped outside the city of Nahor and asked God to set up a divine appointment. His prayer of faith was answered when Rebekah arrived, and it turned out that she was a great niece to Abraham. Rebekah returned home with Eliezer, and his mission was accomplished. But the story doesn't end there. Abraham lost his anointing when he remarried, impregnated a number of concubines, and focused on pleasure rather than righteousness. Many of the faith heroes in the Bible had a shaky start. They were touched by God, grew in faith, and reached a high plateau, only to lose ground and end up in a pitiful state. This message is entitled, Abraham's Selfishness. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm going to finish my sermon today, Can I Trust God? That's a series. And the subtitle today is Abraham's Selfishness. Let me pray. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you right now for touching me when I present this message. I pray, Father God, for your Holy Spirit to guide me, and Lord, give me the words, and take away myself, Lord, that you will be speaking through me. In Jesus' name, amen. Many of the faith heroes in the Bible had a shaky start. They were touched by God, grew in faith, and reached a high plateau, on to lose ground and end up in a pitiful state. This was a case with Abraham. Now, over the years, and I've been preaching now since 1967, I've done a lot of messages. And in the beginning, I would had teaching from other people that was in a church that I grew up. And I never really thought about things between the lines. But the Bible has recorded the good and the bad. And knowing that, I realized this, that you and I are struggling on a daily basis to walk with the Lord, to do what is right. And we think, well, you know, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the others, they were, you know, they just breathed through life and had a good time. No, they were struggling. And as human beings, we are facing the devil, fallen angels, evil spirits, and they will never leave us alone. They always try to mess us up. Now, the last act of Abraham was to find a wife for his son Isaac. If you read from Genesis chapter 24, and Abraham was old and well stricken in age, and the Lord had blessed Abram in all things. And Abraham sent his eldest servant of his house that ruled over all that he had, put, I pray you, your hand under my thigh, and I will make you to swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that you shall not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell, but you shall go unto my country, to my kindred, and take a wife unto my son Isaac. Now, why did Abraham do this? Is it not the woman a woman? If he's a Canaanite, an Egyptian, whatever she is. But in those days, just like now, most people were into idolatry. Now, in the New Testament, Christians are told, you do not marry an unbeliever. It's very clear in the New Testament. You don't marry outside of faith. The Bible does not talk about race. It talks about faith. And so Abraham wanted to fulfill this last assignment he had, that he wanted a wife for Isaac that was not into idolatry. Now, although Abraham's servant is not named in the chapter, it is thought that his name is Eliezer. Now, I worked on that name this week. I cannot remember if I went this way or that way. So I was told, be consistent, so we're going to call him Eliezer. Sounds like cheese to me. In Genesis 15:2, in Genesis 15:2, we have his name there. And Abraham said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless and a steward of my house of this Eliezer of Damascus? Now, this might be the only thing you remember of this message, Eliezer. But that's all right. You might remember some more things. Now, in verses 5 and 8, Eliezer is not sure. He believes that God will find a woman, but he's not sure that the woman will go with him. Because I want you to think about this. How would you feel as a young lady, and suddenly you have a guy show up at your family's house, and he's a steward of some relatives you have in another country? And this guy says, hey, you know, I would like you to come with me and marry this guy Isaac that you never see. And she would want to know, who's this guy Eliezer? Now, I don't know about Abraham. What's the story behind this? It took faith for Rebekah to go. Let's read right now these verses here from 5 through 8. And the servant said to him, peradventure the woman will not be willing to follow me unto this land. Must I needs bring your son again unto the land from whence you came? Well, in other words, he said, now, if it doesn't work out, do I have to bring Isaac back into Mesopotamia? And Abraham said to him, beware that you bring not my son thither again. Abraham remembered Terah, his dad. His dad was called. He got stuck in Haran. Verse 7. The Lord God of heaven, we took him from my father's house and from the land of my kindred, and which spake unto me and it swear to me, saying, unto your seed will I give this land. He shall send his angel before you. You shall take a wife unto my son from thence. Now, Abraham had learned to trust God. He knew now, he said, now there's going to be an angel to go with you. And so imagine this, that you're going to go down to Mexico. You don't know what town you're going to go to. And you're going to find the person that God has said you ought to find. Where do you start? West, East Coast, West Coast, North, South? Where do you go? This is where you have divine appointments. I want you to keep your finger here and turn with me to the, this is the bonus scripture. Turn to Jeremiah chapter 1. That is Jeremiah, the first chapter. And we're going to read verses 4 and 5. Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed you in the belly, I knew you. Before you came forth out of the womb, I sanctified you and ordained you a prophet unto the nations. We have this in Isaiah 49:1. He was also called. We have it in Galatians 1:15, where Paul says he was separated from his mother's womb. So here's what I want you to take home with you from this. Before the creation of the world, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit simply got together and said, we are going to design the human race. Today, if you work for Ford, General Motors, Toyota, whoever you work for, when they design cars today, it's not done the way it used to be when I was an engineer. You have a computer. You have certain programs. And you sit there and you design the car in your computer. You see it three-dimensional. And you can design everything, including the steel, the fabric, and the engine and everything else. And when you're done, the car exists in the computer, but not in reality. It has been designed. It exists in the computer. Now the engineer would take that, he would print it out, and the command will now go to different machineries and places, and other parts will be made, and the car will be made. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit sat down, and they designed you and me. I used my computer, do you understand? They were looking in a tremendous super-duper computer, and they simply said, okay, now, I'm going to pick on somebody today. So I'm going to pick on somebody that's big enough I can pick on, so I pick on Satyrus. So they're going to assign this guy, and they says, well, we're going to make a Greek today. So we're going to assign this guy, so they start designing his features, his body, and so on. And they run a time check, because God can move in time back and forth. And they said, okay, we're going to put him in the 1930s. We're going to put him in Greece. We got these people here, his parents. And so then they looked upon him and says, okay, now we're going to give him. This is the nose we're going to give him. And this is the hair we're going to give him. And then they were looking upon his character. And they put in intelligence. They put in stamina. They put in love. They put in all the attributes that he is. Just like when you buy a computer, you have certain things that's been put in a computer. And then they said, okay, now, this is good. And they looked, they ran a timeline on him and found out that he would find Christ about in the 1980s when he was older. And he was going to get baptized on the Spirit, called of God. He's going to be a prayer warrior. He's going to do this and that. So you are not an accident. You were designed before the creation of the world, selected. You had all your attributes were put into you, and God has a plan for you. And this is exactly what happened here, finding a wife for Isaac. And let me pick it up in verse number 8, and I'm just going to work at a text here. And if the woman will not be willing to follow you, then you shall be clear from this my oath. Only bring not my son thither again. And the servant put his hand under the thigh of Abraham, his master, and swear to him concerning that matter. And the servant took 10 camels out of the camels of his master and departed, for all the goods of his master was in hand. And he arose and went to Mesopotamia under the city of Nahor. Now, no one really knows what the city of Nahor was, and we have not been able to find that through archaeology, but it was not Haran. It's possible that this is the city that Abraham's brother, Nahor, had simply not created, but simply started. So, camels can be without water for 10, 15, 30 days. And so if a camel has been going a long time, let's say 20, 25 days, and not been drinking, when they drink now, they would drink about 300 gallons of water. That's a lot of water. Abraham was rich, so he had sent with him gold, silver, jewelry, all kind of different things. And of course, he had other servants with him. These were actually armed guards, because when you have such a good lot of riches with you, you want to make sure that you have people to protect it. Now, the servant simply was relying upon God. He could have done what so many people do today when they want to get married. They joined one of these clubs. You know, we have singles. You have a club in a church. You have different outfits. And you try to find, you know, on the internet, find a mate and so on. Sometimes it works. Most of the time it does not. Unless you're led by the Holy Spirit to tell you to do that. So he knew this, that the women was going to come out because they had a well outside the city. The women would come out late afternoon, and they would fill up their buckets with water and take them back into the city to cook their evening meal. And he made his camels to kneel down without the city by a well of water at the time of the evening, even the time the women go out to draw water. And now he prayed. Remember this. Most people pray when everything else has failed, right? Just like most men do when you buy something and you have to put it together, the last thing you do is to look at the instructions. Instructions are thrown over here, you try to put it together, and the wife says, you know, shouldn't you read the instructions? Nah, I didn't need it. I know how to do this. Half an hour later, where's the instructions? He prayed. And he said, O Lord God, of my master Abraham, I pray you, send me good speed this day. Show kindness unto my master Abraham. Behold, I stand here by the well of water, and the daughters of the men of the city come out to draw water. And let it come to pass that the damsel to whom I shall say, let down the pitcher, I pray you, that I might drink, and she shall say, drink, and I will give you camels drink also. Let the same be she that you have appointed for your servant Isaac, and thereby shall I know that you have showed kindness unto my master. That was quite a prayer. Now, you people that are women here in the chapel, that are watching, if I give you a bucket that holds 1 gallon, and I send you out to a well that might be 25, 30, or 40 feet deep, and I tell you, woman, I want you to pull up here and fill this tub with 300 gallons of water. And it's hot. It's hot in those days. Still hot in that area. You would look and say, what? 300 gallons? That's a lot of work. I'm not sure. I don't have the time. Why should I do it? You're a stranger. Who are you? But listen now. When you have a divine appointment, the Holy Spirit will anoint you. It will anoint the other person. And it will guide you in the conversation. Let me give you an example. Yesterday, I went up to a city called Yuba City, and we had some chairs that had been upholstered. And my plan was to get there, pay for them, get the chairs, and get out of Dodge. That was my plan. The owner is an American-Mexican, very nice guy, and so he started talking to me. He showed me some things. And you know how it is when you go someplace, you know, you don't want to stay a long time, you know. Okay, yeah, what do you say? That's good. So I realized, slow down, John. You have a divine appointment. You stay here until he is done. He gave me a gift, somebody given him. It was a little box with cards inside, Bible verses. And he said, this is one for every day. You read one every morning, put it in the back, and the next day you take another one. And he said, to Dad. So I realized one of his children had given it to him. He was giving away a gift that was precious to him. So he said, now, I got a letter that I went to the raid. Okay. He said, sit down. So I sat down. I forgot my what. So this is the letter. Now, his dad had abandoned his mother and the family when he was 13 years old. He was a drunkard, and Dad was never around. So I read his letter. It was from his daughter. And she was in her 20s, and she had written this. And it's a letter from her daughter simply saying, Dad, you've been great. And she shared in the letter where he had been for her, how she looked up to him, that he not only said things, but he lived things. It's a very moving letter. So I read it. He said, what do you think? I said, here's what I think. Your daughter knows you inside out. She knows, we cannot hide from our children how we live. For her to write this means you're a nice man. You really have been a nice, wonderful father. I'm sure he's not showing that letter to everyone. He knew I'm a preacher. He's a Catholic. We've been trying to win him for Christ. But what I want to share with you is this. When you got a divine appointment, it is there in an instant. You take it or you lose it. I want to hammer that in. When you got a divine appointment, you might be busy. You're ready to do this or that. But when it comes, stop. Notice that divine appointment will never come back. You take it, you use it, and you be blessed, or you blow it, and it is a missed opportunity. So, the servant here prayed. Verse 15. And it came to pass, before they had done speaking, that behold, Rebekah came out, who was born to Bethuel, the son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother, with a pitcher upon her shoulder, about a gallon pitcher. And the damsel was very fair to look upon, a virgin, neither any man known her, And she went down to the well and filled the pitcher and came up. And the servant ran to meet her and said, "Let me, I pray you, drink a little water out of your pitcher." Notice now, when you have a divine appointment, you got to act. You got to have faith. You act upon it. And she said, "Drink, my Lord." And she hastened and let down the pitcher again upon her hand and gave him drink. And when she had done giving him drink, she said, "I will draw water for the camels also until they have done drinking." The Holy Spirit moved upon her. Because normally, look, folks, let's be honest. We can do things for a family member. We can do things, you know, for someone we know. But for a stranger, to do a job that might take 2 hours or more, this is the Holy Spirit. And the man wondering at her held his peace. He was shook. He realized this, "I'm not going to say a word." To wit, whether the Lord had made his journey prosperous or not. And it came to pass, as he came down drinking, that the man took a golden earring of half a shekel's weight and 2 bracelets for a hand of 10 shekels weight of gold. And he said, "Whose daughter are you? Tell me, I pray you. Is there room in your father's house for us to lodge in?" And she said to him, "I am the daughter of Bethuel, the son of Milcah, which he bare unto Nahor." She said moreover unto him, "We have both straw and provender enough and room to lodge in." And the man bowed down his head and worshiped the Lord. You know, we pray, "Oh God!" And God hears us. We take off. The servant took time to thank God. And he said, "Blessed be the Lord God of my master Abraham, who has not left destitute my master of his mercy and his truth. I being in the way, the Lord led me to the house of my master's brethren." He recognized this was God. And the damsel ran and told them of the mother's house these things. And Rebekah had a brother, his name was Laban. And Laban ran out unto the man, unto the well. Now Laban was a conniver. He was a thief. He was not a very nice person. It is to say that here, but later we find out what he did to Jacob. And it came to pass when he saw the earring and the bracelet upon his sister's hands, and when he heard the words of Rebekah, his sister, saying, "Thus spake the man unto me," that he came unto the man, and behold, he stood by the camels at the well. Laban, money. Wow, this guy's rich. Let's take him over. Let's lighten his burden. Let's get some of the gold from him so the guy is not so heavy laden. And he said, "Come in, you blessed of the Lord, wherefore stand you without, while I prepare the house and room for the camels." That was a lie. He had not done that. That's a con artist. And the man came into the house, and he ungirded his camels, gave strong provender for the camels, and water to wash his feet, and the man's feet that were with him. And there was set meat before him to eat, and he said, "I will not eat until I have told my errand." And he said, "Speak on." And he said, "I am Abraham's servant, and the Lord has blessed my master greatly. He's become great. He's given him flocks of herds and silver and gold and manservants and maidservants and camels and asses or donkeys. And Sarah, my master's wife, bare a son to my master when she was older to him, has he given all that he has. And my master made me swear, saying, you should not take a wife to your son or your daughters of the Canaanites in whose land I dwell. But you shall go unto my father's house and to my kindred and take a wife unto my son. And I said unto my master, peradventure the woman will not follow me. And he said unto me, the Lord before whom I walk will send his angel with you, prosper your way, and you shall take a wife for my son and my kindred of my father's house. Then you shall be clear from this my oath when you come to my kindred. And if they give not thee me, you shall be clear from my oath. And they came this day unto the well. And I came this day unto the well and said, O Lord God, of my master Abraham, if now you do prosper my way which I go, behold, I stand by the well of water, and it shall come to pass that when a virgin comes forth the water, and I sent to her, give me, I pray, a little water of your pitcher to drink. And she said to me, both drink you, and I will also draw forth your camels. Let the same be the woman whom the Lord has appointed out for my master's son. And before I had been speaking in my heart, behold, Rebekah came forth with a pitcher on her shoulder, and she went down the well and drew water. And I said to her, let me drink, I pray you. And she made me haste, and let down a pitcher from her shoulder, and said, drink, and I will give you a camel drink also. So I drank, and she made a camel drink also. And I asked and said, whose daughter are you? And she said, the daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son, whom Milcah bare unto him. And I put the earring upon her face and the bracelet upon her hands. And I bowed down my head and worshipped the Lord and blessed the Lord God of my master Abraham, which had led me in the right way to take my master's brother's daughter unto his son. And now, if you will deal kindly and truly with my master, tell me, and if not, tell me that I may turn to the right hand or to the left. That was a proposal. Now, I took time to read that because I wanted you to again to hear it, a divine appointment. Then Laban and Bethuel answered and said, the thing proceeds from the Lord. We cannot speak unto you bad or good. Behold, Rebekah is before you. Take her and go, and let her be your master's son's wife, as the Lord has spoken. And it came to pass that when Abraham's servant heard their words, again he worshipped the Lord, bowing himself to the earth. Notice now, he didn't care if he had Laban and Bethuel there. When he just bowed down and said, God, I want to bless you again. You got to learn never to be intimidated. Amen. When you're around people, something good happens, say, praise the Lord. Amen. Don't say, I can't say that because they're not saved. That's what you say, praise the Lord. I do that all the time. People either get mad or they're glad. I don't care. I'm going to say, praise the Lord. Amen. And the servant brought forth jewels of silver and jewels of gold and raiment, and gave them to Rebekah. He also gave to her brother and to her mother's precious things. And they did eat and drink, he and the men that were with him, and tarried all night. And they rose up in the morning. And he said, send me away unto my master. And her brother and her mother said, let the damsel abide with a few days, at least 10. After that she shall go. Notice now, the servant, he had urgency. He had found a woman. The deal was made. Time to go. No time to waste. And he said unto them, hinder me not, seeing the Lord has prospered my way. Send me away that I may go to my master. Now catch this, ladies. And they said, we will call the damsel and inquire at the mouth. Laban and Bethuel had agreed to have Rebekah marry Isaac. Rebekah was in another place. She was not part of the deliberations. So they now brought her out and say, hey, you know, we just got you married. You want to go? And they called Rebekah and said to her, will you go with this man? And she said, I will go. And they sent away Rebekah, their sister, and their nurse, and Abram's servant, and his men. And they blessed Rebekah and said to her, you are our sister. Be you the mother of thousands of millions, and you let your seed possess the gate of those who hate them. And Rebekah arose, and the damsels, and they rode upon the camels, and followed the man. And the servant took Rebekah and went his way. Can you imagine the joy now that the servant had? The deal was made. He got the right woman. He had fulfilled. He had trusted God. God didn't let him down. This was a very joyous trip. And then we come down here to the very end here. And Isaac came from the way of the well Lahairo, for he dwelt in the south country. And Isaac went out to meditate in the field at the even time. He went out to pray. And he lifted up his eyes and saw, behold, the camels were coming. And Rebekah lifted up her eyes, and when she saw Isaac, she lighted off the camel. For she had said unto the servants, what man is this that walks in the field to meet us? And the servant has said, it is my master. Therefore she took a veil and covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all things that he had done. And Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent and took Rebekah, and she became his wife. And he loved her. And Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. Now I want to talk about the aftermath here now with Abraham. And I believe that this is something that applies to you and me. On page number 2 of my outline, I said this. I have come to the conclusion that Abraham lost all interest in God's plans once he made sure that he had fulfilled his obligations. He lived the final 38 years doing his own thing. He married again, had a number of children with his wife, and concubines, which are slave women. Instead of Abraham now, he had faith. He trusted God 100%. He could have used his 38 years and said this, I got the written account of the creation. I got the book of Enoch. I got what Noah wrote down. I'm going to compile this. And I'm going to start an educational system. And I'm going to make sure that my servant, he had about 2,000 people working for him, that they all would be having faith in a living God. That he would look upon the Canaanites and said, we're going to start the evangelizing here. And we're going to teach people how to come back to God. But you know what? Abraham didn't care. A lot of preachers, when they get up to retirement age, they retire. Age 65, 66. And they go off into the pasture. Did God tell us to retire from his service? No. We're supposed to be working for God, You might retire from your business, from your regular job. That's a blessing because now you got income coming and you can work for God for free. That's how we got Carol here. She's retired. She got an income. We don't pay her. She's a volunteer. She's doing a lot of work here. She could have been in Texas, you know, sitting around, you know, like this, playing with the grandkids and, you know, going to the sewing club, you know, and crochet or whatever they do. But she's here winning souls, doing deliverances, talking to people, praying with people on the phone. Abraham, I don't know what happened to him. Same thing with Noah. The same thing with King David at the end. These guys lost it. And I see this today in many Christians. You've been faithful for years and you're getting older. You're actually getting better. You have more knowledge. You have more anointing. And you go off someplace in the tulips and just go, ooh. Now, what did Abraham do? Look at this. Let me read from verse 25:1. Then Abraham again took a wife. Her name was Keturah. And she bare him Zimran and Jokshan and Medan, Midian and Ishbak and Shuan. And Jokshan began Sheba and Dedan. And the sons of Dedan were Asherim, Letushim, and Liam Mim. I know what I got the names from. And the sons of Midian, Ephah and Epher and Hanok and Abidah and Eldah, all these were the children of Keturah. And Abram gave all that he had unto Isaac. But to the sons of the concubines which Abraham had, Abram gave gifts and sent them away from Isaac his son, while he yet lived eastward unto the east country. Well, think about this. He got a bunch of other children. He was a dad. And now he decided this, you know. Well, I've been living here for 38 years. I got a whole bunch of new children. You know, I enjoy them. Time to go, children. Get lost. Go east. We do know through legends and now through DNA that the Brahmins in India, these are the highest sect they have, these are the priests, are descendants of Abraham. Hinduism. I want you really to slow down and think now. Abraham could have taken each one of these children and said, let me tell you about Adam and Eve. Let me tell you about God. Let me tell you who you should worship. And Hinduism might never have got it into existence. But because of his sexual drive, his carelessness, his coldness, shipping them off, we have the Hindus. And for the last 4,000 years, because Abraham lived about 2,000 years before Christ, for 4,000 years, his descendants have died, gone straight to hell. Now, we do know Abraham was saved. He was in Abraham's bosom. He met Jesus there. But I don't think that Abraham is going to feel too good at the great white throne judgment when he's going to see his descendants from Keturah, the concubines, standing there by the billions. And turn their head and say, Abraham, you failed us. I want you to turn with me to Revelation right now. Revelation chapter 20. I'm going to read from verse number 11. And I saw great white throne, him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were open. Another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of the things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. The death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Abraham was not going to feel too good. A lot of the people in the Old Testament are not going to feel good. A lot of us are not going to feel good either. When we see people that we could have led to Christ, or we could have done something with, but we didn't. The least thing you can do is to have a Christian tract. The most effective one on the chick tracts, very small. Fill a little pocket, pick it up, put it on the desk, put it in the bathroom. If you can't talk to people, do something. But most of us, we don't. Abraham was comfortable. He was saved. He had faith in God. He was rich. He got all the women he wanted. He didn't care about people around him. That's selfishness. A lot of preachers live like that today. They not necessarily have a lot of women, but they have a lot of money. The big ones got at least have three homes. Vacation home in Hawaii, some in the Bahamas. You don't need to have a mansion here in the United States. And you got to have people drive you to and from, you know. Mercedes is not good enough. You've got to have a Bentley or something of that nature. But we need to understand people are perishing around us. If you turn to Hebrews 11:8, that's Hebrews chapter 11. If you pick it up in verse number 8. Now, Paul is writing about the good things about Abraham. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should have to receive for an inheritance, obeyed. He went out, not knowing where he went. By faith, he sojourned in a land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles, that tents, with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which had foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Abraham looked for a city. He found it. But he did not share that city with his people around him. He was selfish. What about you and me? Turn to Matthew 28. Matthew chapter 28. We read from verse number 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given to me in heaven and in earth. Go you therefore and teach all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things, whatsoever I commanded you, And lo, I am with you always, even at the end of the world. Amen. That's our commission. Are you sharing? Are you part of it? Now, we have many cyber members, different states, different countries. And some of you are supporting us ministry. When you send your money in, that's used to reach people. You get credit for that. At your downline. Many of you are active in your hometown. You might not have a church, but you have groups. You have people you talk to. You have Bible study groups and so on. This is what God wants. I'm not saying I'm a saint, but I'm giving you this example if you understand. Saturday is a day that I lay back. That's my day off, so to say. I don't want to do a whole lot. Saturday night, I don't want to do nothing. I mean, I'm tired. I want to sit there and have a good time, just eat something, you know, and just feel good. Then the Holy Spirit said, call. I was just preparing my dinner, and the Holy Spirit said, call. And I'm looking. I'm preparing my dinner. Call. So I left the kitchen. I did a call. Came back half an hour later. Had my dinner. Now I created work for myself. Work for Soteris. And we got a lot of work to do this week. But you know what? I'm happy. Because Jesse has two sons. One is 9 and one is 6.5. And if we can reach that mother and get her straightened out, get on the road where she should be, I've reached those two boys. And those two boys might be preachers someday. They might be missionaries. They might be whatever, doctors. But you see, Jesse came from a broken home. Divorced. Her mother's alcoholic. Entire side of the family alcoholics. This is what I'm saying. A divine appointment. Every one of you get divine appointments often, but you miss them. What you want to do in the morning is to simply say, Lord, help me to hear your voice today. Help me to hear. Help me to be obedient. And if I got to skip dinner, no big deal. The rewards are great. Final scripture for today is in Proverbs 11. Proverbs chapter 11. And we pick it up in verse number 30. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. And he that winneth souls is wise. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. And he that winneth souls is wise. So, this is the end of my series on Can I Trust God? Abraham did trust him, but he didn't use his faith and trust to reach others. And that's what I want to learn from. He's saved. He's in heaven today. But I'm sure that Abraham could kick himself from one end to the heaven to the other, saying, you know, what was I thinking? I had the opportunity. 38 years. I was rich. Filthy rich. I could have done a lot of things. And I didn't. I pray that you will have faith and trust like Abraham. But it will not be like him in his life. But you will simply say this. I want to share my faith. I want to make sure that others go to heaven. That's how you'd be thinking. Now, you've been watching me, and you're simply saying this, I'm not saved. How can I get saved? Here's how you get saved. You recognize that you're a sinner. Simply tell God this, Lord, forgive me my sins. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe he died on the cross for me. I believe he rose on the third day. I believe he paid for my sins at Calvary. Jesus, come on into my life. Save me right now. I want to be saved. And God will save you. When we finish here, when the broadcast finish, the screen will go change. And you will see three crosses. You would hear a very soothing voice come on and say, my friend. And that would be the voice of Pastor Charles Torell. And he will say, let me tell you more about salvation. Take a few minutes with him. Listen to the scriptures. Pray with him. And make sure that your life is saved today. That your name is written in the book of life. If you do that, would you contact us? We would love to hear from you. So we can pray with you, rejoice with you. And to all of those hundreds and hundreds of people, I don't know how many we got out there, that are walking with the Lord, I want you this afternoon to not just say, well, that was another message, but I want you to slow down and say, Lord, where am I? I trust you. I'm looking for a city. Am I sharing that with others? Do I accept divine appointments? If not, would you repent? Would you ask God to forgive you? And then he will help you to start over again. God is waiting for you. There are people out there that have a divine appointment with you. Get ready. May God bless you as you rise to the occasion. Pastor Charles.
Father God, every single one of us struggles with our identity of who we are as a person. And then once we become Christians, you know, who are we in the body of Christ? And Father, it's a lifelong journey that for some people, they don't care about the answer. They don't care enough to seek it out to the very end. And Father God, I would ask that you would instill in us a hunger and a desire to come to the full realization of what it is that you have done in the past, what you've done in our lives, and the plans that you have for us to accomplish here on this earth. Help us, Father God, to realize the gravity of the situation. Give us a desire, Father God, to seek and save the people who are dying in their sins, that we would not just look at them as something impersonal, but that, Father God, we would see every single person as a loved one, as a family member, that we would, if they were in trouble, we would do anything to save them. So, Father God, give us that desire for the rest of humanity, that when it comes to soul winning, that we would be like that, that when it comes to when we hear, you know, problems that people have, that we would be willing to be emphatic in our prayers for people. In Jesus' name, amen. Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth, and your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you 3 questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all 3 questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these 3 questions are but 3 of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are 3 places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of 2 places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven, All he wants for you is to come to him. He will help anybody who calls out to him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, he will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and he has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. You have been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Durrell. This message was the final part in the series, Can I Trust God?, and was entitled, Abraham's Selfishness. Abraham wanted a bride for Isaac, and so he sent a trusted servant back to the family that he had left behind to find a wife for his son. Eliezer stopped outside the city of Nahor and asked God to set up a divine appointment. His prayer of faith was answered when Rebekah arrived, and it turned out that she was a great niece to Abraham. Eliezer shared his story, and the men of the family agreed this was an act of God, and so Rebekah traveled home with him to marry Isaac. Abraham remarried soon thereafter, but he was not content with Keturah and also impregnated a number of concubines. He selfishly focused on pleasure for 38 years, and before he died, he forced out all the children of these women and ordered them to travel east. Abraham had no plans for them, nor did he show any interest in the welfare of Keturah and the concubines. Many of the faith heroes in the Bible had a shaky start. They were touched by God, grew in faith, and reached a high plateau, only to lose ground and end up in a pitiful state. This was the case with Abraham. It is great to be able to trust God, but it is even greater if we use our faith to reach out to those around us. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1756. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.